Good morning, Grace Life. Let's stand together. We want to begin our time this morning worshiping God for his greatness. We want to sing how great he is and that he brings life and that he is light in the darkness. Let's worship him and adore him this morning. Sing, you give life.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath.
Life, and he is light in the darkness.
You give
there on the mountain top.
This morning. You guys can have a seat.
located in Shadow Lake. Amen. Amen. Amen.
That might have been the last day you were able to be out there. It's the day we had our groundbreaking at Shadow Lake, but that's about to change. In a couple of weeks, we're going to start some preview days at Shadow Lake, and you are welcome to come out on a Sunday afternoon, and we're going to have tour guides leading you around and explaining what's where and so forth and answering your questions. The way you can sign up for a preview day is today when the service is over. Go into the fireside room and you'll see against the table near the kitchen door there some sign-up sheets where you can select the Sunday afternoon that you want to go out there and check it out. And you'll sign up on a block by vehicle, okay? So put just all your people. You don't have to even put their name. Just put your name. And that covers your vehicle, okay, and whoever's riding in yours, because every block represents a parking space. We've got limited parking out there right now because it's a construction site, so that makes sense. So don't put hubby on a line and wifey on a line and three kids on three lines. You just took up five parking spots, all right? Each block's just your parking spot. So preview day's coming up. That's beginning in a couple of weeks. We'll do that for about 6 or 8 weeks. Looking forward to that. But also during that time, it is all hands on deck. The buildings are up. They're out of the ground. And beginning on Monday, October, I think it's the 14th, the framing on the inside of those buildings is going to begin, and it's going to take off, and we need everybody out there. Traditionally, that time of year has been all hands on deck for Pumpkin Patch. Well, just consider it Pumpkin Patch, all right? It's just all together different this time. And so we do, literally, we need all hands on deck. We're going to be out there during weekdays. We're going to be out there on Saturdays. It's just 6 weeks that we're going to step up to the plate, Grace Life, and make some sacrifices, okay? We're just going to have to move some ball game watch parties like we did at Pumpkin Patch. We're going to have to move those out there and watch ball games out there. And some of us may have to kind of sacrifice bow season this year, all right? But about the time gun season's rolling in, right around Thanksgiving, we'll be taking a breath probably, and you'll have a little more time for that. So the next 6 weeks, you'll be getting some more information about that, but be getting your life ready to be a part of that. And we're really, really excited about what God continues to do out there. We don't talk about it a whole lot. I'm thankful for that. The focus at Grace Life is on Jesus. And as big a deal as that is, that's not our focus. But today's one of those days that we just needed to share with you a few things. And as exciting as that is today here in this place with you is even probably more exciting. Here we're here today together to lift up the name of Jesus. And we are glad that you're here. We want to welcome you. If you're new to Grace Life, but you want to know more about what God's doing here, there's a tearaway tab on that worship guide that somebody probably handed you when you came in the doors today. And you can use that to let us know who you are. If you have a specific question, you can use that to ask it. Or if you have a prayer need, you can write it down on there. We'd be honored to get to pray for you. You can sign up for our next Membership Matters class that's coming up, I think, second Sunday of November. We would love to have you there and to be a part of that. It's great to see everybody, especially great to have Kathy Gibson back at Grace Life with us today. So welcome back to Bob and Kathy. Kathy's gone through a very significant illness, and we praise the Lord for how he has healed her and raised her up and brought her back here into fellowship with us today. Hey, one more thing. You know, the Bible teaches us to love our neighbors as ourselves, and so last Sunday, a neighbor in the Loveless Park community called me and said, hey, would you do me a favor? And I said, well, if I can. They said, well, could you ask your church members to slow down after Sunday church lets out? So I said, I will communicate that. I know what's happening. We got a big traffic jam on the Lou George Loop side. And some of you smart cookies have figured out to go down Loveless Park Loop and then to Pocahontas and get around the traffic. That's a great idea. Just don't be in such a hurry, all right? Just pretend that's your children and grandchildren out there playing near that road and just calm it down. Right, Brother Ken? You're on that street, so I got an amen from Brother Ken. Just settle down, y'all. Let's love our neighbors. I promise you the Methodist already beat us to the restaurant, so just take your time, all right? It'll be okay. Well, let's stand. Let's go to the Lord together in prayer today. Lord, we bow before you today, and we continue to give you thanks for your great faithfulness that is expressed among us in so many ways, Lord, from restored health and people coming to know Jesus to how you continue to provide resources, God, for us to move this faith family out to Shadow Lake. But most of all, we're here today to celebrate your son Jesus and who he is, what he has done in our hearts and our lives, that we are only right with you because of his finished work at the cross. Holy Spirit, you come now and do what you always do so well, which is to make much of him. God, I pray that as he's lifted up, you would draw us to Jesus again today. And we'll thank you and praise you for this, and it's in his good name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Take a moment, meet some new friends today, welcome one another, invite somebody to worship with you today. Let's have a good day in the Lord.
I was lost, and you came.
sounds so great. I love hearing you all sing. I love hearing you sing out. I'm thankful that we're at a church where you guys sing along with us. And when we sing this song, this next song, it's called Only a Holy God. And I was reading a devotional about this song this morning, and it had a phrase that stuck out to me. It said, you become what you behold. You reflect what you worship. And the reason why it stuck out to me is because I began praying for myself, and I began praying for us as a church that we would long to behold more and more of God's glory in our lives so that we would know Him more and so that we would know His heart. And so the things that He cares about would be the things that I care about and the things that you care about. And that when I would see His great grace and His great mercy, that I would realize that I need to show that kind of mercy to other people. The things that He is passionate about, things that He is uncompromising about, the things that he is only concerned first and foremost for His glory above everything else, that's what I need to be concerned about first and foremost in my life, is His glory above everything else. And that's what this song is, Only a Holy God.
Splendor outshines the sun.
you guys can have a seat.
Boys and girls, if you'll come, ushers, if you come to receive our offering, we have the best praise band in the world, but my favorite part is always when it's just our voices, right? Oh, we got a baptism video. My bad, dude. Y'all watch this video. JR, it's my friend.
Here I am with Parker Bowden, and he has his hands lifted in praise to the Lord today. And as you can tell, Parker had an accident just a few days ago, broke his hand. So we're going to try to hold that up out of the water today so we don't get that wet. Parker's a great young man. His dad Nathan's here with him. Mom Emily's up here watching. And we're thankful for Parker. He's heard about Jesus from his family and from church a long time. And not too long ago, Parker, you trusted Christ to save you for yourself. Is that right? And Parker comes today to publicly profess his faith in Jesus today. So, Parker, I'm going to scoot over here and help your dad make sure we don't get that arm wet. Upon your profession of faith in Jesus as your Savior and your Lord, your dad baptizes you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in death and raised to walk in new life.
That was a first. Well, good morning, guys. It's great to see you guys today. If your last name is Piper, you got on a walking boot, I think, right, these days. So I heard about that. So you guys got to be more careful with what you guys are doing. Y'all are so brave and courageous. So listen, I'm hearing great things about Sunday school with you guys. First of all, how many of you went to see at the poll Wednesday at your school? To see you at the poll. You went to your school flagpole and prayed? Yeah, huh? I went to yours. I sure did. I was at Lakeview Elementary School. By the way, there's a new church starting today at Lakeview Elementary School. Today's their launch day called Church 220. You might have heard of them or seen of them. So I want you to pray for them today as they start a new church here in our community. They're already partnering with us. We're trying to start a new Christian club at Lakeview Elementary. They're going to help us with that. And we just got the go-ahead this week from McAdory Elementary to start an FP Kids Club at McAdory Elementary, too. So we're thankful for all that. What you guys are learning in Sunday school, I'm really excited. You guys are going through a thing called the Gospel Project. I think our adult Sunday school teachers just heard a little bit about the Gospel Project. One of the things I love about the Gospel Project is how it's just walking us through Scripture, kind of like you guys, we've learned that, right, in the Gospel timeline. We did that last Sunday, and so I know what your lesson's going to be today. I'm going to go ahead and tell you what it is, but we got to think about the timeline. I'm not going to do the whole timeline, but let's do part of it. We'll do part of it. How about that? Now today you tell me to do it. If I said I was going to do it, you went, oh, no. Oh, that's Jimmy that does. He's just like, that's Jimmy, not me, okay? Well, so in the very beginning, God created two people, and what were their names? Adam and Eve. And y'all have learned about that in Sunday school already through the Gospel Project this year. And Adam and Eve, did they obey God or disobey God? Disobey God. That's called sin. You had a Sunday school lesson on that as well. But even though they sinned, God stepped into the garden and he made them a promise. He promised to send a Savior. But in the meantime, sin just got worse. And so God sent a flood, and he destroyed the whole world except one man, Noah, and his family. You guys had that in Sunday school, I think, last week in Sunday school. And after the flood, the people began to repopulate the earth, and they built the Tower of Babel. And that's your Sunday school lesson for today. This is why I'm really loving what they're doing in Sunday school, because it's following what we're doing also with them, trying to teach them Jesus through the whole Bible. And that the Tower of Babel, that's Babel, that's when God came and he confused their languages. And that was the beginning of the nations of the earth. And out of all those nations, he chose one man to start a new nation. His name is Abraham. That's next week. All right. So we'll hold off for that from there right now. But let's ask Mr. Jade Beck to come, and he's going to pray for us today. He's our deacon today. And these boys and girls brought offerings to the Lord today, Mr. Jade.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Are you a good carpenter? You going to be framing and all that stuff, helping us out?
I'm going to help out, but I'm not good.
Yeah, me too. I'm going to be like a toter of lumber or something.
Me too.
Okay.
I can carry a lot of stuff.
You're a pretty strapping young guy, so will you be my lumber toting partner?
Yes, sir. I'll help you.
You will always have the heavy end, okay?
Okay.
All right, good. Deal.
Let's pray before I get into something I shouldn't. Lord, we love you. God, we're so thankful to be here in your house this morning, Lord. And I just pray that as we hear from your word, our minds and our heart will be open to receive it, that we would leave here challenged and changed, different than we came in, Lord. And I just pray that you would bless these tithes and offerings, God, and use them to further your kingdom. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, brother. Thank you, boys and girls. If you have a Bible today, let's go to John chapter 15. And I'll ask your forgiveness. I am a little bit under the weather. As probably a lot of you are. Pastor Rick told me this morning, he said, they're saying it might rain next Sunday. And I said, you know what? I think this church family would walk to church in the rain at this point just to get it, right? I just feel like it would flush a lot of this stuff out of us that we're dealing with. But I'm thankful we get to go to John chapter 15 together. Every year our staff goes on a retreat together and we analyze and we think and we pray and we plan and we dream, and it's kind of almost a nonstop working sort of opportunity for us, which is really beneficial just to have a place where we can have sustained thought for a long period of time. That's hard to do here. There's always a lot of wonderful interruptions, and that we count those as blessings, but you need some time for sustained thinking, and so our retreats serve as well to do that. And the last couple of years, I've challenged our team to write down on the dry erase board on our retreat a word or a few words that kind of describes where you think Grace Life is right now. And so this year I kind of waited for everybody to write their word or their phrase up there, and then I wrote one word, my word, for where I think Grace Life is right now, and it's the word pregnant. Pregnant. And so I just wanted to, I told somebody this week. I had lunch with one of our members this week, and I was sharing that with him, and he said, well, you need to start the sermon Sunday by just standing up and going, hey, we're pregnant. But I would be afraid that would be all that some of you would hear, and then my wife would whoop me when I got out of here. What in the world are you thinking? But I think that's a great word that really describes what God is doing at Grace Life right now. I do believe that this church family is pregnant with opportunities that God's putting before us. I believe this church family is pregnant with possibilities to see God just work in us and through us in a way to bring Him so much glory and to win people to Himself. And I think that that means that God's continuing by His grace to line us up as the church family more and more with who He is and more with His purposes and with His plans. Because I know this from God's word, and we're going to see this today in John chapter 15. God intends that His people would bear fruit. Did you know that? Like, He didn't just die for us so that we could be saved, but even in that and through that and from that, He desires that we would bear fruit, and not just fruit, but that we would bear much fruit. And I do sense that among us today, that there is a sense of great expectation that God is about to deliver great fruitfulness for His glory by His grace through this church family. And I could fill up your time today talking about how I'm seeing that and expecting that. One of the ways is with our boys and girls and with our teenagers. As you know, I teach high school students on Wednesday nights, and I got to say this, I started doing this 25 years ago, but I've never seen a generation that is as hungry for God's word like this generation, Generation Z. I'm head over heels in love with this generation. That Generation Z is kind of everything from like 22 on down right now. And that is a special bunch that we're getting to minister to. I just kind of sense a pregnancy of God's purpose in their hearts and their lives. And to get to be a part of that is so exciting. So I see a lot of fruit on the vine at Grace Life, and we praise God for that. And I see that in so many different ways. And I think this is where we need to ask ourselves, well, what about me personally? Am I bearing fruit in my life? And not only am I bearing fruit, but am I bearing, as Jesus says in John chapter 15, am I bearing much fruit for his glory? Much fruit, is it being borne out in my life? And I think that's the question we need to ask ourselves. Today we're in John chapter 15 in a sermon series called 24, The Day That Changed Everything. And when this started for us in the upper room a couple of months ago, we saw Jesus there with his disciples, and it was the beginning of this 24-hour window of time. And that 24 hours is going to culminate with some friends of his laying his dead body in a tomb. All that is happening in this 24-hour span. And so where we are in John chapter 15 is Jesus and his disciples have just walked out of that upper room where we've seen all these things transpire that we've talked about. They're beginning to walk now toward the Mount of Olives, to where there is this garden there called the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus is going to pray there. His disciples are going to sleep there until they're awakened by a commotion of this Roman guard coming at the behest of Judas, who will betray Jesus with a kiss. And so as they're making their way to the Garden of Gethsemane, some people speculate that there might have been a vineyard along the way, and that it was maybe beside that vineyard that Jesus stopped and he seized that moment as an object lesson for his disciples. He is in his final hours with them, and he is pouring tremendous truth into their lives that you and I get to benefit from today as well. Listen to his words there in that night of John chapter 15, late on Thursday night now. He says in 15:1, I am the true vine, and my Father's the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I've spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. Let's pray. Lord God, would you help us today to receive your word, to understand your word. Holy Spirit, would you change us by the power of your word? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I don't know a lot of great growers in the room, so let's just kind of start off with an agricultural lesson, if you don't mind. Jesus says, first of all, in verse 1 there, I am the true vine. I want to show you a picture of a grapevine in case you're not really familiar with what we're talking about. So you can kind of see what I would call the trunk of that. It looks like a small tree. When Jesus says, I'm the vine, he's talking about what to me looks like the trunk, the base of that. He says, I am the vine. I'm the vine. And by the way, when he said that, he's using the holy name of God, Yahweh. I am. He is here again claiming to be God. And when he says, I am the vine, that probably shook the souls of his Jewish disciples. Now, for you and I, we hear him say, I'm the vine, and we think, okay, that's kind of weird. There's probably some hidden meaning there. But that meaning wasn't so hidden for his Jewish disciples. For his Jewish disciples, they understood that all throughout the Old Testament, time and again, God had used the imagery of a vine to describe them as his people, Israel, the Jewish people. He spoke of them as a vine. And usually when God spoke of his people as a vine, it was kind of like when your mama called you by both your first and middle name. You chuckle because you know what that meant, right? If you got called out by your first and middle name, you're in trouble. And when God would call his people, refer to them as a vine, typically it was in that way. He was typically saying to them, you are my vine, but you're not bearing fruit. You're not living in obedience. Righteousness is not found among you, and judgment is coming. But Jesus, in John chapter 15, he takes that idea of the vine, and he does a 180 with it. And Jesus says, I am the true vine. Now think about this. In other words, Jesus is saying to his followers here, I am doing what you cannot do. And I will do what you could never do. What you cannot and could never accomplish, I am accomplishing that. This is the gospel. This is the gospel. Jesus is speaking over their failures. He is speaking over their faithlessness. And he is declaring, hey, you couldn't, but I can. You couldn't, but I can. You're the great I am nots, but I am the great I am. You could not please God with your life. But with hours left in his life, he's declaring, I have pleased God with my life. No sin found in him. Jesus is declaring to them, you could not bear the fruit of righteousness, but I have. You can't live perfect lives, but I can. You cannot reconcile yourself to God, but I can do that for you. They tried to reconcile themselves to God, and sometimes they tried awfully hard, but all their greatest efforts just always fell short. Romans 3:23 tells us that all of us have fallen short, haven't we, of God's standard of holiness and of righteousness. But Jesus is on the scene here, and he's declaring to them and to us, hey, I've got this. I've got this. I'm the great I am. I am the true vine. You are not, but I am, and I am what you could never be on your own. Jesus is the vine, which means he is the source of life to us. We can't be the source of life to ourselves or to anybody else, but Jesus is the source of life to us. I am the vine. He is that vine, that trunk. He is the provider of life. He is the provider of all that we need, not us. And then Jesus says, look at this. His Father is the vine dresser. In other words, his Father is the one who is tending to this vine and to its production. His Father is the master of this whole endeavor. You know what the vine dresser does, right? He plants the seed. That's what God the Father did. He planted the seed of his son in a young Jewish virgin named Mary. Not only does he plant that seed, but the vine dresser plans the ways of that vine. He'll take a trellis. He'll lay it out. He will know the way that he wants to direct that vine. He'll plant it out. And Jesus time and again told us that he was doing the work of his Father. He was carrying out the plans of his Father. That's what the Father did as the vine dresser. So this is who God is. Jesus is saying, I am the true vine, and the Father is the vine dresser. Now, who does that make us? Well, the Bible tells us that we're the branches. And Jesus only leaves open the possibility here of two different options related to branches. First, in verse 2, we find the branches that don't bear fruit. Look at verse 2. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And what does he do with the branches that don't bear fruit? Skip down to verse 6. He says, if anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. Now, I don't want to camp out and spend a whole lot of time on this. I spend quite a bit of time encouraging church members to make sure of their salvation. I probably could be accused of doing that more than average, perhaps. But I do that, A, because it's biblical. It's all throughout Scripture. And I do that, B, because I love you. And I want you and me to work together, to encourage one another, to admonish one another, to make sure that we are indeed sure of our salvation. That's why we do that. I don't want to just assume that because we've walked a walk or checked a box that we're legit. I don't want you to make those assumptions either. It's possible to go a long time giving the appearance to be a part of the vine, but come to find out You're not. Remember now in John 15, they're fresh on the heels of an example of precisely that, right? For 3.5 years, Judas had appeared to be a part of Jesus. He had appeared to be a part of that vine. But just moments earlier, that was proven to not be the reality. So I'm just going to tell it to you straight what Jesus is saying here. A real Christian bears fruit. That's it. A real Christian bears fruit. Listen, if there is no fruit, then there's no genuine belief. If there's no fruit, then there's no salvation. Now, if that's true, and I believe it is, then how you define fruit becomes awfully important, right? What kind of fruit are we talking about then? Pastor, if you're telling me if there's no fruit, then I'm not a true believer, then what is the kind of fruit that I'm supposed to be looking for in my life? Well, listen, if we define bearing fruit as external, moral, religious, Bible Belt kind of ways, then we're no better than the Pharisees, are we? We're just looking at the outward appearance of things. And that might be how religious people define fruit. But that's not how Jesus defines fruit. I would rather have the author of salvation tell me what the definition of this fruit really is. And I believe he does that through the Apostle Paul in Galatians chapter 5. Listen to these words. But the fruit of the Spirit. Now listen, he's about to give a bunch of words here. These are not different fruits of the Spirit. Love is not a fruit, and then joy is a different fruit of the Spirit. This is all the same. These are just different ways of looking at the same fruit of the Spirit, okay? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Is that you? You see the fruit of the Spirit in your life? Do you see love or hate? Joy or bitterness? Peace or conflict? Patience or impatience? Kindness or rudeness? Goodness or meanness? Faithfulness or disloyalty? Gentleness or harshness? Self-control or lack of control? You know the thing about fruit? Fruit grows, doesn't it? Fruit progresses. It's a progression. And so when we talk about bearing fruit, we're not talking about perfection. We're talking about progression. Is this the direction that your life is progressing in? Are you finding that you are becoming more loving with time, more gracious, more kind with time, more patient with time? We're talking about progression. Do you see that progression of the fruit of the Spirit in your life? I don't think anybody in this room heard me read Galatians 5 and went, nailing that. I got that. I don't even really know why I'm here today, because I am so on top of all those things that you just said. I'm batting 1,000. I don't think anybody here would make that kind of claim. But if you're truly saved, you're moving that direction progressively. But if you're not going there and you really don't care, then I would suggest to you today, according to God's word, it would seem that you're still dead in your sin. If you're not going there and you really don't care, that would say that it could be because the Spirit of God doesn't dwell in you. You may have hung around Jesus, and you may have externally joined his vineyard, but you really aren't connected to him. Because if you were really connected to Jesus, the life of Jesus would be seen in your life. And if you don't see the life of Jesus in your life, it could be evidence that Jesus is not truly in your life. And then there's a second possibility of what kind of branch that you are. We find it at the end of verse 2. And that's the kind of branch that bears fruit. True believers. People that are true followers of Jesus, right? And do you know what Jesus does for those of us that are his true believers? He cuts us. Some of you didn't see that one coming, right? We were ready to go, oh yeah, we have a potluck. Yes! No, He takes out a knife. He takes out shears. And he prunes us, is what the Bible says. Look at that. Verse 2, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes. If we're honest, we might say, I wish that said something different. For those that bear fruit, he blesses, right? He holds them up. He does wonderful things with them. But that's not what it says. It says those that bear fruit, he prunes. Why would he do that? Look at the text. Every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes. Why? That it may bear more fruit. He wants us to bear more fruit. In other words, if we go back and look at that grapevine that I showed you earlier, he wants the life that is in that vine to be manifested out through those branches so that it results in fruit that reflects the character of the life that flows through that vine. Does that make sense? There's a reason grapes are on that vine, because it's the life of grapes that's flowing through that vine. It's not going to bear anything else. And that's what Jesus wants. Jesus says, I'm the true vine. And I want it to be my character and my glory that flows from me, the vine, into you, the branches, and results in you producing much fruit that is reflective of who I am in this world. And what that means is he's going to be cutting away things in our life that are not consistent with his character. You tracking with me? He's going to be cutting away things in our life that are not consistent with who he is. And sometimes what that means is he's going to be cutting out sin in our life. But more times than not, it means that he's going to be cutting out not so much sin, but he's going to be cutting out self. It's not necessarily bad things that he's pruning. In fact, typically pruning is about the removal of things that aren't necessarily bad. John the Baptist understood the principle. He said, I must decrease so that he must increase. There's got to be less of me and more in him. So to increase his fruit in our lives, he's going to prune us back so that there's less of us, so that there might be more of his fruit in our lives. Now, that's actually kind of encouraging if you think about it. When Jesus goes to prune in you, first of all, what that means is you're a true child of God, right? So that's encouraging. That's an assurance of our salvation to know that Jesus is saying in the pruning process, you belong to me and you're mine. And I see fruit in your life, but I'm going to prune you back because I want to see even more fruit in your life. And listen, I'm not going to lie to you. When God goes to pruning, it's painful. Many of you know that to be true, but let me remind you, this is not God punishing you. In fact, God doesn't punish his people. Disciplines, yes. Punishes, no. He's already punished Jesus for all the sin that we have and ever will commit. You say, but it feels like he's punishing me. No, he's pruning you. He's pruning you. And when he's done with whatever you're going through, the result is there's going to be less of you, and there's going to be more of him. I see Raymond nodding back here, and man, Raymond went through a cancer battle some years ago, and Raymond, he didn't know I was calling him out today. Did you find that at the end of all that, you look back and thought that God was pruning me through that squeezing, that hard time going through that? God was at work cutting away some good things in Raymond's life, things about Raymond. But at the end of that journey, there was a whole lot more Jesus that was being born out through Raymond's life. Many of you have that similar story today. There's less of you now than there was. Some of you are in that season right now where it feels like you're being squeezed, where it feels like you're just struggling relationally. Or maybe you're struggling financially, or maybe you're struggling professionally, whatever it may be. And hear this, that doesn't necessarily mean, those struggles don't necessarily mean that you've done something wrong. It could mean that. Sin brings consequences. God doesn't punish us, but when we sin, we set consequences into motion. I don't want to rule that out. But it could be that what you're going through is that Jesus is pruning you, right? It could be that he's at work to make sure there's less of you and more of him. Just because you're going through a hard time right now, it doesn't mean that you're a slacker of a Christian because you don't have this happy, clappy, come on, everybody, let's give Jesus a round of applause. Because you're really feeling that inner struggle. Whoever told you that following Christ was easy probably wasn't a follower of Christ, were they? Because following Jesus, while the best thing in the world, is not the easiest thing in the world. If you're a follower of Jesus, you will be pruned. It's going to happen, and probably often. Look at verse 3. Right after telling us we're going to be pruned, Jesus delivers some really good news. He says, already you're clean because of the word I've spoken to you. Jesus tells his disciples that they're already clean. You know why he's already cleansed them? Because they've believed. They believe. They're not clean because of anything they've done. They haven't done anything yet. In fact, quite the opposite. They're about to mess up big time. But even knowing that, Jesus declares that they're already clean by grace through faith. These guys are 120 minutes away or so from running away. They're 120 minutes away from denying Jesus. Peter's going to do that with curses. But Jesus says to them, you're clean. In view of all that, he still says they're clean because they've believed his word. See, you became a branch in God's vineyard not because of anything you did. You became a branch in his vineyard by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. So if he's pruning you today, here's some good news. You're never closer to Jesus than when he's pruning you. When he's pruning you, he's holding you. He's bringing you close. He's deeply looking into your life, examining your life. He's near to you in that time of pruning in your life, seeing beyond your today and looking into your tomorrow, so that tomorrow you're bearing more of his fruit than you did today. See, this is really, really extraordinary good news. He is committed to you bearing more fruit, his fruit, in your life for his glory and for your joy. The more your life brings him glory, the more his glory is going to bring your life joy. So he's holding you close, and some of the things that you think are so good, he's removing some of those good things from your life because he wants there to be greater things in your life. He loves you too much to allow things that are simply good to drain what is best from you. I grew my first real garden this year. Pretty proud of that. That's become my hobby, my therapy, you know. So I grew corn and grew okra and squash and peppers and cucumbers. I kept the ladies in the office rolling in cucumbers because I only eat them if you pickle them. But I made pickles this year. My goal, one of my life goals, is to become a meemaw. I just want to, I want to learn how to grow stuff like meemaw and cook stuff like meemaw. And I've got the pan-fried okra thing going pretty well right now, I think. There's a lot of other things. I had a good visit with Miss Louise Hammett this week, and she was thinking very clearly, and so I capitalized on that moment. I said, I need to know how you do cream corn. And so she sent me home with a bag of corn. So I this week, one night, I'm going to follow her instructions, you know, so I'm going to try to do that. Tried to grow some tomatoes. I wasn't real successful with that. Some of you are really good tomato growers. I learned a lesson. I didn't know about growing tomatoes. I learned about suckers. Anybody know about suckers? Yeah. Well, here's the deal about suckers. Yeah, on a tomato plant where you got a couple of branches, they're going to fork like that. In the fork of the branch is where a sucker is going to grow. And it looks pretty. I mean, you know, if you're a rookie gardener like me and you're like, man, this plant is really growing, right? Because it's got this stem and leaves begin to grow up. And you're like, man, this plant is really taking off. But then as I'm watching Google videos, because my meemaw, the gardener's with the Lord, and now I look back and go, man, I should have asked a whole lot more questions. So if your grandparents are still alive, talk to them a lot. Ask a lot of questions, okay, because now I'm stuck with Google. And It sort of gets the job done, but not quite like your grandparents would get that job done. So I learned about these suckers, and come to find out, those little suckers are actually taking up all the nutrients that's flowing through the vine that's supposed to go to those branches that's going to grow those tomatoes. And if you really want to harvest some tomatoes, you got to spend some time getting up close to your tomato plant and find these little suckers. So I started learning how to look for suckers. And if you catch these suckers, when they're young, tender little suckers, you can just grab them. This is entertaining, isn't it? Some of you feel like you're watching YouTube right now. So you grab the little sucker between your, index finger and your thumb, and you just pinch them, and you just pull them off of there. And the plant probably thought, hey, what are you doing? I like that. I mean, this is a part of me. Why are you taking off a part of me? But look, I'm not into growing suckers, right? I'm trying to grow tomatoes. And that's what God does for us. He comes near to us and he finds what looks to us like, hey, God, this is not a bad thing. In fact, this is me. This is a part of me and this is my life. And God says, well, that part of your life is draining your energy away from me. That part of your life is distracting you from me. That part of your life, well, not necessarily bad in and of itself, it's hindering you from bearing much fruit. And I want your joy to be complete. And so I love you too much to just let you grow suckers in your life. But I'm going to prune those back from you. And it might hurt. It does hurt sometimes. But Jesus didn't die on the cross to grow suckers, did he? Gave us life that we might bear much fruit for his glory and for our joy. Now you might be thinking, well, how can I avoid all these suckers in my life? Just something about that term we're finding comical, isn't it? How can I avoid growing so many suckers in my life? How can we just cut that off at the pass, right? Jesus kind of gets into that in verse 4. Watch this. He says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I'm the vine, you're the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So verse 4 and 5 is reminding us that by grace through faith, we're now united with Jesus, right? We're connected into him, the vine. He abides in us, and we abide in him, and we have this unbreakable relationship now with Jesus, the King of glory. And because we have this relationship with him, because now he has removed our sin, he now delights in us. And this is where some of us really struggle. We find it hard to believe that Jesus actually delights in me, right? And we find that hard to believe because a lot of us just don't like us. And we deal with other people who don't like us. And Jesus, who is perfect in all of his glory, is saying, well, I like you, and I delight in you. And we find that hard to believe. And the way we live our lives shows that we find it hard to believe that he actually delights in us. And I'll prove it to you. If you've ever been sitting at a red light or a stop sign and you got to pull out there in traffic and there's this line of cars that's coming and you wait and you wait and you wait and then you pull out into traffic, but about the time you do, you realize, oh gosh, I should have waited on that one last one to get past me because I really pulled out a little too close to them. And then, no, that's how it always goes. Like 100 yards later, you're stopped again and they're right behind you, like right behind you. And you know the place where you don't want to look? The rearview mirror. Right? Because you're afraid if you look in the rearview mirror, they're going to be looking at you. And you don't want to look at them because you're convinced you just offended them. And here's our human nature. When we think we have offended, we try to avoid. And that all started in the Garden of Eden, didn't it? When Adam and Eve had offended God, what did they do? They tried to avoid God. When I come home from work tomorrow, my children don't come and greet me when I get home tomorrow. They probably did not have a good day at school, and they know that Dad's going to be offended, and so they're already avoiding me, right? You've been there, maybe on the giving or receiving side of that kind of confrontation. That's what we do. We try to avoid people when we think that we have offended them. But Jesus is telling us here, listen, abide in me, not avoid me. He's telling us that we never have a reason to have to avoid him. Because of what Jesus did at the cross, there's no more offense between you and God. He's no longer offended by you or your sin because you have been robed in the righteousness of Jesus. And so no longer do you have to duck and dodge him, but you get to run to him. He's telling us in John 15, don't avoid me, just abide in me. You don't have to clean yourself up to come to him. Just come to him. He'll clean up whatever needs to be cleaned up. All he's asking of us is that we would simply abide in him. You say, what does that mean? Well, I think to abide in him just simply means that I keep my mind and my heart on him, right? We talk about my mind's attention and my heart's affection. Listen, true or false, right? If I'm keeping my mind's attention and my heart's affection on Jesus, there's going to be a lot less suckers in my life. Right? Doesn't that make sense? My energy is just going to be going toward Jesus. My mind's attention's on him. My heart's affection is on him. And I would just ask you this question today. What is it that helps you keep your mind's attention on him? What is it that helps you keep your heart's affection on him? I think that's the most practical question of the day today. Some of us really need to be thinking about that. Thinking about ourselves and asking ourselves that question. What is it that helps me abide in him? What helps me keep my mind on him, my heart on him? Some of you might say, well, getting up before the sun comes up, watching the sun come up, having my Bible, reading God's word. That helps me to abide in the Lord. Some of you would say, sitting out under the stars, listening to worship music, that helps me to abide in him. I'm a fan of both of those things. Listen, there's certain places in this world that just help me love Jesus better. And there are certain people in this world that just help me love Jesus better, right? And you could probably say the same thing. So what stirs you up for Jesus today, right? What moves your heart to abide in him more and more? What stirs you up for Jesus? Pursue more of that. Who stirs you up for Jesus? Pursue more of those people. And the flip side is this question. What robs you of that? What robs you of your affections being on him? What robs you of your mind's attention being on the Lord? What robs you of your heart's affection being on the Lord? I don't know what yours is. I don't mind sharing what some of mine are. Country music. When I started gardening, I don't know why, I felt country. I started listening to more country music. I grew up listening to country music. I did. I fell asleep many a night listening. I love 80s country music. Listening to Ronnie Millsap, classic Alabama, you know. Man, I love that 80s stuff. And I'm not anti-country music, but you know what? I've discovered I've got to watch myself when it comes to listening to country music, because if I listen to a steady diet of it, it begins to dull my affection toward Jesus. Now, I'm not trying to convict you about what you listen to. I'm just being honest about me. I got to watch that, right? And when it's really convicting is when you hear your children in the back seat singing about beer, and you're like, oh, shoot, too much country music. Got to go back to, you know. So I have to listen to Pandora, all right? I make my own Christian stations because I don't necessarily dig what's on the radio, no offense. But or like another thing, me and Shannon, we don't watch a lot of television. We have 4 kids, so we don't get to watch a lot of television. But when we do watch television, we just don't watch a lot of coarse stuff. Because we've come to realize that just really dulls our affection for Jesus. It just begins to impact us. I know there's Walking Dead fans in the room, and I'm not trying to be the Holy Spirit in your life, but when that became real popular, you know, we're like, okay, what is that about? And it took about 5 minutes for us to realize that's not us. I can't have a steady stream of entertainment that is things that grieves the heart of God. I just can't do that. Here's another one. I can't follow sports too closely. I love sports. Y'all know that. There's Alabama fans that now are excommunicating me because I wore an Auburn shirt last week. I didn't mind doing that. I really didn't. And by the way, I noticed your team was a whole lot better after I wore the shirt. I'm just saying, got a little of my mojo on you, right? So, but I know that I could get all caught up in that. You know, in some way, I think maybe wearing an Auburn shirt was good for me. Now, when I stopped in Tuscaloosa at a store on the way home Sunday, it got awkward fast. But because I know that I can be pulled into that so much that it could begin to dull my affections for Jesus. And so I just want to push back on that. I haven't even watched the whole Alabama game yet from yesterday. There was just a time in my life that I just kind of said, listen, I can't rise and fall with what a 19-year-old does with a ball, right? I mean, it's a great hobby, but it's a lousy God. And so I just don't want to be too given to that. I just want to be careful. I love it, but I don't want to love it too much. I want to enjoy these good gifts, right? But I don't want them to become suckers in my life. I could be a news and politics junkie. And some of you are. And I'm not trying to be the Holy Spirit to you. But I'm warning us ahead of 2020 because I know the temptation is going to be to just be junkies with the news and the politics. And I could go down that path, but I know that there's been times in my life that's been a sucker in my life. It's just drained my affection away from Jesus. Listen, I already know this. The outlook for the nations of the earth is not good. In fact, I know this without a shadow of a doubt. Soon there's coming a day, none of the nations of the earth are even going to exist anymore. So why am I going to give so much of my time and energy to what's going on in the political landscape of the world? There ought to be a better balance in my life about that. I'm not saying let's all be ignorant or be irresponsible citizens, but I'm saying I just got to guard myself not to fall into that. I know what stirs me up to love Jesus. I've walked with him long enough. I know the people that stir me up to love Jesus. I know the places that stir me up to love Jesus. I know the things I can take in that stir me up to love more. And I know, I've lived long enough now to know the things that can dull my affections toward Jesus. And so this is where I just want to stop, and I just want to throw the spotlight on you, just between you and the Lord. In fact, I would just ask you where you sit, just to bow and close your eyes and just think about you for just a moment. And maybe even as you do that, you just need to jot down a thought or two that the Holy Spirit may bring to your mind. You need to evaluate today. Am I bearing fruit? Am I bearing the fruit of God in my life? Is there love or hate? Is my life marked by love or hate? Is my life marked by peace or conflict? Is my life marked by kindness or rudeness? Is my life marked by being faithful or disloyal? Is my life marked by joy or bitterness? Is my life marked by patience or impatience? Is my life marked with goodness or meanness? Is my life marked with gentleness or harshness? Is my life marked with self-control or lack of control? If you're not bearing fruit, then you got to ask yourself, am I truly born again? And if I am bearing fruit, then what does God want to do in my life so that I bear more fruit today than I did yesterday? Which leads to this question then, what for me does abiding in Christ look like? What stirs up my affections for Jesus? What stirs up my love for Jesus? Who stirs up my love for Jesus? And the other question is, what suckers have I allowed to distract me from him? What suckers in my life have I allowed to drain my focus, my energy, my attention away from Jesus? And maybe it's some people that I've allowed is to take my affection away from Jesus. And what am I going to do about that? What am I going to do about that so that I am more consistently abiding in the one who by his grace already abides in me? Can I just tell you, I need to tell you, would you be intentional today to consider these things? Would you be intentional today to develop a plan in your life? And for today and for this moment, here's where it starts. In this moment, it starts with just confessing, Lord, I need you. I need you. Would you work in my life today? Would you prune what needs to be pruned? I want to bear more fruit for your glory and my joy. Teach me to abide in you. That's where it starts today. Lord, I need you. Would you make that the confession of your mouth, your heart today? And let that confession lead us today and this week to a freshness in our abiding with Jesus. Holy Spirit, thank you for guiding us through the word today, for speaking to our hearts. Lord, I do pray that today we would know that your Spirit, Holy Spirit, that you would affirm with our spirits that we're indeed children of God, that we would take an honest assessment of our life, and I pray that we would see there is a progression of Christ-likeness in our lives. We had a long way to go, but I pray that you would affirm to us today that we indeed are the sons and daughters of God, and if we're not, that you would convict us and you would draw us to salvation. God, that today we would desire to bear the fruit of Jesus in our life more in the days to come than in the days past. The reality is, if we are truly born again, that will happen. Whatever we've allowed into our lives, God, that it may not be bad. I just don't think a little country music is necessarily evil. I don't think football is necessarily evil. I don't think watching the news is necessarily evil. But God, if that stuff goes unchecked in my life, I become this person with all kinds of stuff growing on me. I got a knowledge of all kinds of useless things. I'm not bearing the fruit of the Spirit. So today, I know you'll come and prune, but I know you also delight in your children pruning themselves sometimes. So give us the grace to do that. And we start right here, right now, by just saying, Lord, I need you. I need you. I can't bear fruit without you. I can't live without you. I can't go on without you. I've been walking in self-defense far too long, but Lord, I need you. I need you. Let's stand together. Let's respond to the Lord. You're welcome to come and pray. You're welcome to pray with someone. You're welcome to pray where you are, or just make this your declaration. Lord, I do need you. Change my heart. Change my life. Without you, I fall apart. Hey, you know, while I was talking about some of my things, I saw this look on some of your faces, and I know that look. It's the same look I've given people when they've poked at my idols. Same look I saw from some of you when you kind of felt like some of your idols got poked a little bit today. Well, all I can do as your preacher is occasionally poke your idols. But Jesus loves you so much, He'll topple your idols. Won't He? He will. A lot to think on today. Hope you have a great Sunday school class. We got some great starter questions I wrote for you this week. And I've already written the starter questions for your Sunday school class for next week. And that one's going to be a good one and a fun one. You're going to like that one too. So God bless you guys. Have a great day and a great week. See you soon.